This unusual aircraft is like no other. It can fly into space. Unlike conventional rockets, this one sheds no parts during descent and flies back to a runway like an airliner. Its history dates back to the 1980s. So, why isn't it in the sky today? Since the early 1960s, engineers have envisioned the rocket of the future, flying to space like an airliner, then returning and being reused, only requiring refueling and new cargo. A single staged orbit vehicle, or SSTO. It's not a new idea. From giant post-Apollo concepts in the 60s for mission to Mars, to unusual space shuttle alternatives in the 80s, to more practical concepts in the 90s that would actually reach early prototypes, but none of these would reach the orbital prototype phase. So, why don't we have SSTOs today? To start, let's see why rocket stage in the first place. Rocket stage for two primary reasons. The first is to shed weight. Engines, fuel tanks, recovery hardware. That all adds up to your final dry mass. This directly impacts payload orbit. One extra ton of fuel tanks is one less ton of payload. The second reason is to switch engine configuration. At sea level, you don't need a lot of thrust, but as the air thins, a larger nozzle is ideal for fuel efficiency, and you don't need as much thrust anyway. But those usually don't work very well on the ground, unless they're specifically engineered for it, like the space shuttle engines. Many rockets could technically SSTO with their first stage, like the Falcon 9, Unfortunately, its payload capacity wouldn't be very impressive. So, engineers face the challenge of building a spacecraft extremely light, while also being reusable. There's a variety of approaches, but today we're going to focus on one British special agent. Bond. James Bond. Sorry, wrong script. Bond, Alan Bond. In the 1980s, Bond was working on fusion technologies. While there, he theorized a new kind of engine, a hybrid between a jet and a rocket engine. By utilizing the atmosphere, you could reduce the amount of oxidizer stored on board. And so, HOTOL was born. HOTOL would take off from a runway in air-breathing mode, up to Mach 5.5, almost twice the speed of an SR-71. Then, it would switch to the onboard supply of oxidizer for the rest of the trip to space. It would open its cargo bay, deploy up to 8 tons of cargo to orbit, then return home and land back on a runway. All with the goal of reducing the cost of putting things into orbit to 1/5 that of the American Space Shuttle. However, the program encountered issues. Because HOTOL was designed like a normal rocket, with engines at the back, it faced CP/CG mismatch. As the fuel drained, the center of mass shifted backwards and the center of pressure shifted forwards, causing aerodynamic instability. To address these issues, a new design evolved to push the center of pressure back. However, this came at a cost. HOTOL got heavier, 4 tons heavier. This meant the payload capacity dropped from 8 tons down to just 4, 1/6 of an American space shuttle. In an attempt to gain back some payload capacity, HOTOL was given a detachable undercarriage for takeoff, while keeping a smaller one for landing. But this wasn't the only issue. At such incredibly high velocities, the temperature of the air is too high for the jet engine to handle, so it must first be put through a pre-cooler, a system of thin tubes full of liquid helium that instantly cools the air to just above liquefying. It worked very well, so well the pipes quickly frosted over, blocking airflow across the pipe. In a 1985 assessment, HOTOL was thought to take up to 20 years to develop at a cost of $5 billion in 1985 money. Unfortunately, the British government weren't willing to invest that kind of money on a far-off project. By 1989, the project was cancelled and HOTOL was dead. Bond initially approached European governments to continue the program, but there was a problem. The engine design and patent was classified under the Official Secrets Act, so he couldn't tell anyone how the engines worked. This was not the end. In 1989, Alan Bond and engineers John Scott and Richard Barville founded Reaction Engines Limited to continue their work, supported by private funding. HOTOL was dead, but a new design rose from the ashes. Instead of placing the engines in the back, they were moved onto the wings near the center of mass, reducing the center of mass shift during flight. They called the new concept Skylon. I've added rear canards to the design to make it fly better in KSP, otherwise it's very close to the real concept. No further research had been done on HOTOL's engines by Rolls-Royce, so Alan Bond used alternative designs to work around and improve on the Rolls-Royce patents, the same ones he originally wrote. The result was SABRE, Synergetic Air-Breathing Rocket Engine. Approaching Mach 5.5 and 80,000 feet up, Skylon begins to pitch up, ascending into space. As the air thins, the intakes are closed and the engines switch to the onboard supply of oxidizer to continue the trip to orbit. We'll be right back. with a better design, improved engines, and lighter construction, Skylon is capable of lifting up to 15 tons to low orbit. Skylon could lift a variety of payloads, satellites, crew carrier modules, space station components, or even parts of a Mars vehicle. But here, it's carrying the Skylon upper stage in order to transport satellites into geosynchronous orbit while still remaining fully reusable. Once it reaches target altitude, the satellite is released and continues to orbit under its own power. The upper stage comes back down and uses the last of its propellant to rendezvous with Skylon again. For re-entry, Skylon takes inspiration from the SR-71. Instead of using ceramic tiles like the space shuttle, it's coated with a single corrugated skin of glass ceramic material, and it maintains a higher altitude during re-entry, so it doesn't get as hot. Skylon has returned home, fully intact and ready for refueling and another mission. But this was 20 years ago, so what's the status on Skylon today? It remains purely a concept. It would still take billions of dollars to get a prototype ready to fly, with super lightweight materials on a complex aircraft, and one that must avoid repeating the space shuttle by having a low cost to refly it after each mission. But what has made slow progress is its engine technology. They were able to solve the icing issue, and have successfully tested various components of the engine. The technology has attracted funding from the European Space Agency, as well as the UK Space Agency. There's more applications for it than just space planes, such as hypersonic airliners. Reaction Engines Limited also continues to look into using its technology for eco-friendly airliners, such as ammonia-powered jetliners. But will we ever see Skylon or any SSTO in the future? Reusable rocketry is already starting, and a fully reusable vehicle promises all the key points of an SSTO. It's fully reusable, and only the upper stage has to endure the full force of re-entry, landing right back on the pad, literally into waiting arms, allowing for rapid reuse, at least in theory. Perhaps chemical engines, even ingenious ones like SABRE, are just not quite good enough for SSTO adoption. With better propulsion technology, SSTOs are inevitable. But until then, fully reusable two-stage orbit vehicles might just be our best shot. But maybe in another timeline...